Church in the community should be there to meet the needs of the community. Not only did Reverend Castle have a vision, but he had the determination to act on God's ordained vision. Through his foresight, faith in God, and spiritual inspiration, Friendship West Baptist Church became a reality. On the second Sunday in June of 1976, a total of 9 worshipers had the inaugural worship service at the Mary Lewis Sweat School of Dance on Liberty Lane.
It's a crazy story. West came together 1975, the year before the birth of Friendship West. My dad asked me, as I was graduating from my middle school, junior high school, we called it then, would I join him in a road trip from San Francisco to Dallas? That meant I had to miss the trip to Disneyland with my class, graduation, all that stuff, but it was with my dad. And so I took the road trip with him. And we drove from San Francisco, or he drove from San Francisco to Dallas with a stop on the way from my sister's graduation and in Southern California. And so we got to Dallas. We get to Dallas, and Reverend Robert L. Castle, who went to school with my dad, evidently at Bishop College, he wants to take us out to eat. And so we go out to eat, and I'm 14 years old, not really paying attention, but I recall him talking about, I'm gonna start my own church. And that really tripped me out, like, you know, how do you start your own church? I am a member of Third Baptist, which is, you know, in excess of 100 years old. So I'm tripping, why are you starting a church? I don't know anything about that, but I remember in that conversation between Reverend Castle and my dad that he's, you know, talking about starting a church, his vision and all that stuff. And as a 14-year-old, I'm like, I don't see how that's going to happen. The next time I see Reverend Castle is 3 months later when my dad passes and he and his wife come to the funeral. And, you know, I remember him greeting me.
We joined the first year, 1976. My sister passed that little A-frame church on Polk and told us, I saw black people coming out of that building. So we were amazed, and that week, our founding pastor, Reverend Robert L. Castle, knocked on my door, inviting us to church. I said, oh no, I have a small child, not yet 2 years old, and he's not adjusted, so we don't go to church anymore. He said, that's okay, that's what my church is, mostly just children. If he talks too much, we'll tell him to shut up. If he moves around, we'll tell him to sit down. I said, if you're sure that's okay, we'll be there. And the next Sunday we went and joined.
So, of course, 3 years later, I'm at Bishop College and start preaching a year after that. And interestingly, one of the things that, again, blows my mind in the backstory is that I was scheduled to preach for an MLK service in Beaumont, Texas.
Well, good morning, Friendship West family. Can you go ahead and get on your feet? Because today is not only the last Sunday of the year, it's the last day of the year, 2023. And I don't know how your spirit is while you're in the house today, but you made it. You're here. You're here in the presence of the Lord. And God will take it from there. Can you go ahead and put your hands together? Get excited that you are in the presence of the Lord. I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord, giving praise, high praise, high sounding praise. Clap your hands, sing your song, get excited, because we made it. We made it. God is good, and he'll take it from there. He's got your dreams. He has your pain. He has you in his hands. Let's go ahead and lift him up in our prayer. God, you are a mighty good God, an amazing God. We thank you for another day's journey. Thank you for bringing us all the year through. Whether we had high days or very, very low days, God, you kept us all the way. Thank you for carrying us when we couldn't pick up. Thank you for wiping the tears from our eyes. Thank you for giving us vision and for dreams. Thank you for coming to get us. God, you are a mighty and an awesome God. And we thank you on this final day of the year and this worship service, oh God. We give you thanksgiving and we give you praise. Thank you for allowing us to worship you, to praise you. We lift up your name. We magnify you. We love you. Have your way and be glorified. You are God and God all by yourself. So right now, God, in our spirits, we lay ourselves prostrate before you. We worship you. We adore you. You are God and you are good and you are mighty. Thank you, Lord, for another day's journey. Thank you. We're not going to worry about yesterday and before we ask you about tomorrow. Just right now, we want to give you praise. So receive our praise. Receive our worship. We love you. We love you. We love you. We thank you. Hallelujah. Thank you for your son, Jesus. Thank you for caring for us. Thank you for keeping us. Thank you for healing us. Thank you for saving us. Thank you for reconciling us. Thank you for redeeming us. Thank you for this season. Thank you for the privilege of prayer. Thank you that you're a God that answers prayers. We love you. We trust you. We believe you. We worship you. Have your way in this place. Be glorified. God, be glorified. God, be glorified. In Jesus' name, we pray. In his name, in his name, in his name.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord, everybody. We have come into this house to lift up the name of Jesus. We have entered into his gates with thanksgiving and into his courts with praise. Come on and put those hands together and bless the name of the Lord with us. Hallelujah. Is anybody excited to be back in the house of the Lord on today? If you're glad, put a smile on your face and clap those hands and rejoice with us.
Into his gate. Into his gate.
Yeah.
Bring praise.
your head, O people of Zion, and lift your voice if you came to bless his name. We just want to take this moment of praise and worship to a Most High God,
yes, God,
who is truly deserving.
Yes, God.
And on today, it is our hope and wish that you lift your voice and sing with us this next one. We all know it, and I believe it will be fitting for the last day of the year for us to sing the highest praise.
Yes, Lord.
Hallelujah.
Yes, Lord.
Salvation and glory. Honor and power,
yes,
unto the Lord our God. Why are we doing it? For the Lord our God is mighty. Huh? Has he been mighty in your life this year? He is omnipotent. The Lord our God is wonderful, beautiful. Come on, church, help us. Lift your voice and sing hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Salvation.
Salvation and glory.
Honor and power.
Honor and power unto the Lord our God.
Sounds beautiful, church. For the Lord our God is?
For the Lord our God is mighty.
Yes, the Lord our God is omnipotent.
Yes, the Lord our God is omnipotent.
Truly the Lord our God.
The Lord.
He is wonderful.
Our God.
Hallelujah.
He is wonderful.
One more time, all over the building, sing hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Salvation and glory.
Salvation and glory.
Honor and power.
Honor and power.
Unto the Lord our God.
Unto the Lord our God.
When we think about all the ways he's made for the Lord.
For the Lord.
The doors he's opened, all the times
yes,
he's healed
Lord,
you.
Our God is omnipotent.
Deep down in your soul, you got to know that
the Lord
truly he is wonderful.
He is
it all right if we take it up, church, one key? Let's move a little higher, lift your voice and sing hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Salvation.
Salvation and glory.
Oh, God is pleased by the sound of praise.
Honor.
For the Lord our God is mighty.
For the Lord our God is mighty.
Testify that yes, the Lord.
Yes, the Lord our God is omnipotent.
The Lord our God.
He is wonderful.
One more time, all over the building, lift your voice with us and say, hallelujah. Through with this praise, church.
Salvation and glory.
Honor
and power
unto the Lord.
Unto
man, come on back in and drive that for me right here.
Hallelujah.
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 wonderful. Come on and lift your voice. If you know that he's wonderful, to the Most High God, to the Alpha and the Omega, to the author and the finisher of our faith, we sing hallelujah. We bless your name. Truly, if it had not been for you, we wouldn't have made it to this place. So with every bone in our bodies, with every breath in our bodies, we hallelujah your name. We make your name great in this place. King of kings, Lord of lords, the sacrificial lamb who came to redeem us. Is anybody grateful for Emmanuel? Is anybody grateful for Emmanuel? Is anyone grateful for God with us today? Hallelujah.
Send up glory. Why? Because honor and power. I said honor and power. Honor and power. Grace and authority belong to our God. All praises be. I said all of the glory. I said all of the glory. All of the glory. All of the honor. It don't belong to me. It don't belong to you, but all of the glory, all of the honor, every praise, every worship belongs to our God. Somebody shout hallelujah. Come on, shout glory. If it had not been, I'm just thinking about 2023. For the Lord who was on my side, I don't know where I would be. So hallelujah. 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 Salvation. For saving and delivering and keeping and healing. All of the glory. All of the glory. It belongs to our God. I don't know about you, but I will praise him while I have a chance. Hey, the old folks will say, I may not have this chance again. So we bless you, Lord. We honor you, Father. We give you praise, Lord. We shout hallelujah. We take a pause in the praise bringing. We just shout to your name and we give you glory and praise. Hallelujah. Come on, hallelujah. Come on, give God praise as you go to your seat. Come on, Shabbat the Lord as you go to your seat. We honor the Spirit of Christ. For it is in him that we live and move and have our being. Come on, give God a hand clap of praise if you're glad. As the old folk would say, to be in the service. One more time. He didn't have to do it. He didn't have to do it. But I'm just glad. Hallelujah. To be in the service. One more time. We also give God praise for the presence of our senior pastor, the angel of this house. We thank God for Reverend Dr. Frederick Douglass Haynes III. And we give God praise for him, his presence today. He's on assignment. Get your Bibles because there's going to be a word, amen, from the Lord. We want to also celebrate and honor all of our visitors who are here with us today. If you're visiting with us, this is your first time with us, your first time visitor. If you're here in the sanctuary, we would that you would stand. If you're online and you're visiting with us for the first time, we again thank and praise God for you. I'm looking around the sanctuary. God bless you. God bless you. I see some Chiefs fans in the house. Amen. God bless you. Amen. God bless you. God bless you. My brother. God bless you, family. God bless you. God bless you. And again, for those of you who are watching us online, we're so delighted that you're here with us. That sound of praise you just heard in the sanctuary is for those who are present with us, but also for you online. As you're watching us again across the city, across the country, across the world, do us a favor. Hit that like button. Hit the share button if you're online or you're in person and you want to know more about the great work of Friendship West, our discipleship ministries. Would love to minister to you. You can send us a text, FWBIZ. Send that text to 28950, FWBIZ to 28950. If you have a church home, we send you back with our choicest blessings. If you are church homeless and you're in search of a church, you can end your quest at Friendship West, because we ain't got nothing but, I love that part, we ain't got nothing but love for you. So we thank God for all of our visitors. One more time, give God praise for those who are visiting with us. We also have so much to be excited about today as we are welcomed into our family of faith through the work of our discipleship ministry today. New members, give God praise for our new members. Would y'all go ahead and stand? Come on, let them see you. We want to show you off. Come on, give God praise for our new members who are here in the building. Caden Armstead, Alexia Austin, Catrice Banks Johnson, Erica Barnes, Val Barnes, Shirley Boss, Raquel Melton, Sister Tracy Brewington, Lee Curry, Darius Duncan, Cheryl Gillum Freeman, Fumasan Hock, David Johnson, Lane March, Janice McLemore, Mary Manuel, Stephanie Middleton Williams, Carvin Nelson, Lashara Scott, Keandra Stewart, Parissa Tanner, Deja Todd, Glodine White, and Sister Stephanie White Robinson. Come on, one more time. Give God praise. Y'all don't know when to shout. Give God praise for all those who have joined and become a part of this family of faith known as Friendship West. And we are indeed grateful for you, each of our new members, as well as the work of our discipleship ministry for making it happen. Now, you already know you can spend all day with your family of faith today as we end 1 year, as we say goodbye to 1 year, as we say hello to another year. We're going to be in worship all day, so you're here at 10 o'clock. If you're not here at 10 o'clock, you still got time to meet us at 7 o'clock p.m., where Dallas's own brother Myron Butler will be with us, and then we got at 11 o'clock p.m. That's right. Give God praise for our 7 p.m. experience. And then at 11 o'clock p.m., we're going to honor the tradition and the legacy of our ancestors who welcomed the word of freedom on December 31st, 1862, knowing that January 1st, 1863, they would be liberated from the bonds of their oppression. We know we are still doing the work of making emancipation a reality for all of God's children, but we are encouraging you, we're urging you, join us as we welcome in 2024 with 1 hour of power and praise, a meditation for our senior pastor. We're going to be in prayer. We want you to be in prayer with us. So mark your calendars for the remaining worship opportunities that are going to be presented to you here at Friendship West. And we give God thanks and praise for each and every one of them. We also have an update for the women of the West. I believe update for the women of the West at the facility for their celebration has been moved. The Emerald Brunch is now going to take place at Kitchen and Cocktails, 1933 Elm Street, Dallas, Texas, 75201. I want you to govern yourselves accordingly if you are making plans to attend the Emerald Brunch hosted by the Women of the West. That's all the announcements that I have for you this morning. Come on, give God praise, because it's offering time in the house of the Lord. No. We get excited about giving at Friendship West because we know we have so many reasons that we are to give. We're going to urge, I challenge you today as we end this year. Amen. Be sensitive. Be obedient to the move of God. Amen. We know that this celebration, we're getting ready to, old folk would say, this is a part of worship everybody can participate in. We're getting ready to walk this morning. We're going real old school this morning. So you're going to be able to walk. Those of you who want to, you're going to have an opportunity to walk this morning to give your offering. But I want want you to be mindful of the fact that for those of you who are going to be giving, going to be obedient, going to be sowing, be mindful that that tithe is your, those of you who will be faithful in tithe, that's a 10% off of the top of everything that God has given to you. And our offering is that which is above and beyond our tithe that the Spirit lays upon our heart to give to the work of supporting ministry here at Friendship West. God blesses us to do so much, but we can't do any of it without your obedience and without your faithfulness. There are several ways that you can give here this morning. Of course, you can text to give by texting FWBC to 972-200-9419, FWBC to 972-200-9419. You can also use the Givelify app. Download that app from your app store. Search out Friendship West. Give through Givelify. You can also give online at friendshipwest.org through the Friendship West Baptist Church app as well. There's also the QR code. For those of you who are watching us online, you can scan the QR code there in the corner of the screen. We've also got the old school offering envelope. That's real good for those of us who are going to be walking and giving this morning. Your old school offering envelope, our deacon's ministry, amen, is prepared to receive that this morning. However you're going to give, whatever you're going to give, I would that you help us to consecrate it unto the Lord. Lift it up as we consecrate it unto God and believe God's word to be true. Lord, we thank you that all that exists belongs to you. And so, oh God, we can't struggle. We don't struggle. We dare not struggle to give all that we have back to you, because you did not think it robbery to give all that you had, your very best, even for us. Bless gift and giver the same. May these gifts be used for the work of the ministry to make justice arrive on earth as it already exists in heaven. Help us to be obedient to what your word says do. In the name of Jesus, we pray through the Holy Spirit according to your word. And amen. Please pay attention to the ushers, amen, as we are governed by them as we give this morning.
Hallelujah. Come on, as you're in your giving, go ahead and put your hands together with us. Simple song. Now I believe you catch on to it. Help us sing. Come on right here, choir, say he's all right.
He's all right. He's all right. He's all right.
Some of y'all may know this one.
He's all right. He's all right. He's all right with me.
Say it again.
He's all right. He's all right. He's all right with me.
Truly the Lord is all right with me.
He's all right. He's all right with me.
He's just
all right.
He's just all right.
He's just all right.
He's all right.
He's all right. He's all right. He's all right.
Is the Lord all right with you on today?
He's all right. He's all right. He's all right.
Say the Lord, he's all right.
He's all right. He's all right. He's all right with me. He's all right. He's all right. He's all right with me.
He's just
all right. He's just all right.
He's just all right.
He's just all right.
Oh yeah.
Oh yeah.
Let's say that one more time from the top. He's all right.
He's all right. He's all right. He's all right.
Is the Lord all right with you on today?
All right. He's all right. He's all right.
Come on, put them blessed hands together. He's all right.
He's all right. He's all right. He's all right.
Try. tell him about my troubles. I trusted the Lord.
I tried him.
When nobody else would help me, I went to him and he heard my cry.
I tried him.
And when I tried him, y'all, guess what? Say, I found out.
I found out.
He's a covenant keeper.
I found out.
He's a mind regulator.
I found out.
He's a bridge over troubled water.
I found out.
He's peace in the middle of
I
a storm. That he is a keeper.
I found out.
He consolated. You ought to show some sign in this place. Hallelujah.
I will praise him while I can. I'll bless him at all times. And I vow to praise you through the good. This is my testimony in all that I go through. Somebody said, why? I said, because praise is what I do.
Great and greatly to be praised. Praise God with me for our wonderful praise dancers. Did they not bless us? While you're at it, let's thank God for our wonderful choir. Y'all on fire. Thank you so much. God bless you. And we praise God for you. I got word this morning that Congresswoman Eddie Bernice Johnson has transitioned. And so we want to remember her family in prayer, her loved ones. Congresswoman Johnson, of course, was a legend, and God used her in a great way as a trailblazer. And so we remember with gratitude and with fondness all that she has done, and we again pray for her family. We pray for her constituents. We pray for all who are impacted by what has taken place. But we also thank God that she has blessed us with a legacy that we can carry on. So we salute her. Let's pray. God, we thank you and praise you that you are God and you are good. We thank you and praise you for your faithfulness. We thank you and praise you for the power of your word. Now, God, speak to us. You know how we feel. You know what we're dealing with, what we're up against, and what we are going through. We need a word from you. We need to hear from you. If we don't hear from you, God, what shall we do? So please, remove all distractions. Don't let me or anything in me or about me get in the way of what you are up to and what you want to say and accomplish through me. Hide me behind the cross. And help us to see Jesus, and we'll give you all of the glory and honor, for you are our mother and father who art in heaven. Empty me of myself. Fill me with your Holy Spirit. Take over my mind and my mouth and this message, and let your word go forth with such power that none of us leave this encounter, this experience, the same way we came. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Let me thank you so much for your prayers. You have no idea how much I appreciate what God did as a result of your praying. This thing, it knocked me down, and it was rough. And so missing y'all was difficult, but I am so grateful for your prayers. And so for all of you who blew my phone up and... It's very funny when Pastor Magruder asked you not to do that. That's exactly what you did. And so I was wondering what was going on. I said, why is my phone blowing up right now? And it was the love. And so thank you so much for the love and for your prayers. I want to call your attention. Even though I miss being here, we didn't miss hearing the word. And so I want to thank Pastor Magruder and Pastor Kia Westbrook for allowing the Lord to use them in such an amazing way. At Kia Westbrook, she had this line that just got me. She said, you quoted a girl, Taraji, who said, the math ain't mathin'. Yeah, yeah. And then she said, but the gift keeps on giving. That thing got me through the week. Thank you so much for the word. I want to call your attention in this service to Matthew chapter 2. And there in the second chapter of Matthew, if I had been healthy, we would have been talking about the names of our Savior during this season. And so I'm going to try to catch up without giving you all of it, because I can't preach all of it in one sermon. And plus, I know y'all want to get back for tonight. So Matthew chapter 2, beginning at verse 19, it reads from the New International Version translation of the Greek New Testament. After Herod died, an angel of the Lord appeared in a dream to Joseph in Egypt and said, get up, take the child and his mother and go to the land of Israel, for those who were trying to take the child's life are dead. So he got up, took the child and his mother and went to the land of Israel. But when he heard that Archelaus was reigning in Judea in place of his father Herod, he was afraid to go there. Having been warned in a dream, he withdrew to the district of Galilee, and he went and lived in a town called Nazareth. So was fulfilled what was said through the prophets, that he would be called a Nazarene. You may be seated in God's presence. I want to put a tag on this text, and for a few moments with your prayers, I'd like to use as a subject from which to preach straight out of Nazareth. Straight out of Nazareth. I think it was the poet Masefield who said that life is a terrible headache on a noisy street. Wow. A terrible headache on a noisy street. Stress is all in each and every word of that picturesque phrase, life a headache on a noisy street. For whenever one has a headache, the last thing you need is to have it compounded by noises. And yet, according to the poet, when you look at this thing called life, every now and then it feels like a headache that hurts on a noisy street that is compounding the pain that you are experiencing. Wow, what a picture of stress, a headache on a noisy street. Earlier this year, I was preaching in Syracuse, and when the driver picked me up, I was asking him about the weather and how bad it could get. And that's when he volunteered that last Christmas was for him the holidays from hell. And then he went on to explain transparently that somehow heaven had interrupted the hell that he and his family had experienced. He lives in Syracuse, but his son and his wife and granddaughter live in Buffalo, and they decided that they would meet up in Buffalo for Christmas Eve and then travel from Buffalo to New York City in order to experience the beauty and the glory of Christmas in the Big Apple. Well, he makes his way from Syracuse to Buffalo. And when Chris arrived in Buffalo on Christmas Eve, it was then that he discovered a once-in-a-generation bomb cyclone was just about to hit that area. As a matter of fact, the bomb cyclone of 22, it hit an area from Michigan to New York, upstate New York, and as well as northern New England. And when the bomb cyclone hit, the bomb cyclone caused a great whiteout, the bomb cyclone, caused power failures as snow and ice, down power lines. Watch this. All of this is taking place on Christmas. Listen to what Chris said to me as Chris is driving me from the airport in Syracuse to my hotel. And Chris says, it became the holidays from hell interrupted by heaven. And then he talked about spending Christmas in the dark. Here it is. He and his family were making plans or had made plans to go to New York City. Needless to say, flights were canceled and they ended up spending Christmas in the cold. They spent Christmas in the dark. It's a horrible way to spend Christmas, and that's the testimony of Chris, his son, his daughter-in-law, and his granddaughter. They spent Christmas in the dark. Listen to Chris as Chris talks about his son who was trying to make a wonderful Christmas for his granddaughter, and yet the stress of it all was wearing on him. After all, their plans had been upended by circumstances beyond their control. I think I can stop right there, because that's enough to stress you out. That is a headache on a noisy street whenever your plans are upended and somebody is looking at me right now. I don't know you, but God has me in your Kool-Aid. I just called out your flavor because you know what it's like to make plans and then have your plans upended by circumstances beyond your control. You have worked hard. You have paid your dues. You have set everything up, and then everything you have set up, it falls apart. Why? Because of circumstances beyond your control. It happens. Wait, I'm not even done. Chris also had not only made plans with his family that were upended by a bomb cyclone, a once in a generation event, but now they find themselves in the dark at Christmas. Listen to how Chris insightfully interprets what's going on. He said, Pastor Haynes, ain't that a trip? We are celebrating the birth of the light of the world in the dark with no power. I think I'll stop right there because in a real sense, he's talking about the contradictions that occur in this thing called life. Life is filled with stuff that makes no sense. Contradictions where here you are trying to do good, and that's when life goes bad. Here you are standing up for what's right, and that's when everything goes wrong. Life is filled with contradictions. I was moved powerfully by a scene that was sent to me by the wonderful activist Sarah Mercuria, and Sarah sent me this scene that was on the news, not yet in this country, but on the news internationally in other countries. Al Jazeera, it was a picture, it was a nativity scene of the babe in Bethlehem. Wait, not with a beautiful setting of shepherds and angels. Instead, it's a setting, my sisters and brothers, with the Holy Family in the midst of devastation and destruction. It's our Redeemer born on top of rubble. Of course, y'all know we copied it and had it commissioned and done right there in the lobby of our own worship facility, because it speaks of the contradictions of the fact that even though we are celebrating this holy season, there is hell in what is known as the Holy Land. Hell in the Holy Land, my sisters and brothers. That's exactly what's happening right now. Hell in the Holy Land. After all, we have watched as the response to the hell and horror of October 7th has been disproportionate in terms of the Israeli response. And the Israeli response didn't even take into consideration the context of constant
hell that the Palestinians have been living in for decades as a result of the apartheid-like conditions that they find themselves under. Don't take my word. Take the word of Jimmy Carter. Take the word of Desmond Tutu. Take the word of Nelson Mandela. Both Tutu and Mandela had known what apartheid looked like. And when they both went to visit Palestine, they were struck by the similarities between what the Palestinians were dealing with and what they had dealt with there in South Africa. I'm just letting you know that whenever you take a text out of context, it becomes a pretext that cons people. And one of the things that the news in this country will not do, it does not speak of the context of October 7th. Yes, October 7th was evil and wrong. Murder is murder. Murder is wrong. But don't forget, it occurred in the context of constant murder at the hands of the apartheid regime there in Israel. Wait. Because I cannot talk about the apartheid regime in Israel without talking about it being enabled by the regime of the empire known as America. And so, my sisters and brothers, just this past week, please know that as we are watching the hell that is being experienced by the Palestinians, the president of this country bypassed Congress and sent more funding to enable the carnage that is taking place. Watch this, all while lighting the White House Christmas tree and hosting Christmas parties about the Prince of Peace. There is something hypocritical about hosting Christmas parties celebrating the birth of the Prince of Peace while you are enabling and funding hell and horror in the Holy Land. I'm just trying to say, my sisters and brothers, that this Christmas is filled with contradictions. It's the Christmas from hell. It's a Christmas that is stressful. It's a Christmas that for far too many of us is downright dark. And with that being the case, I thought I would look at this text afresh, because this text reminds us that the Holy Family found themselves in a dark place. Watch what the text says. Joseph and Mary will testify their plans were upended. After all, they were planning on building a life together when all of a sudden Mary comes up knocking up, and the Bible lets us know it's by the Holy Spirit. Don't play holy on me like that, okay? The Bible says that Mary is pregnant, and if Joseph discovers that she's pregnant, he knows it's not his, and he wants to put her away privately, because the text says he's a man of integrity and his character counts. I like that right there, because when you are a person of integrity, you handle things in a way that reflects respect. And that's why whenever you are talking about hooking up with someone, look beyond the clothes to check out their character. Look beyond what they drive to find out what's driving them. Look beyond what they have and make sure that God has them, because in this thing called relationships, character counts. Everybody that looks good ain't good. And so, my sisters and brothers, note with me that Joseph decides, I'm not going to publicly humiliate her because I'm a person of integrity. And I love this, because Joseph handles it privately, but here comes an angel of the Lord saying, no, don't do that, because she's about to give birth to a Savior whose name shall be called Jesus, because he's going to save us from our sins, both our sins within and the sin we live in. To use the language of Jesse Jackson, wait, I simply say this, that Jesus is so good that Jesus' name means that he saves us from us. Jesus saves us from getting in the way of us. Y'all looking at me strange right now, but let's be real. A lot of us, if we're honest with ourselves, we are where we are not because of other people, but we're where we are because we made the decisions. We were stuck on stupid. We did what we did. But the good news is I serve a Savior who will save me from me. I serve a Savior who, when I get in the way of me, gets me out of the way of me and delivers me from me. And somebody came to church or you're online, and that's your shout right there. And that is, our Savior will deliver you from you so that you won't keep getting in the way of you, becoming the you that God intends for you to become. Preach, Freddie Haynes. I'm doing the best I can. Hold on. Watch the Bible. The Bible now says that Jesus saves us from sin within and the sin we live in. Jesse Jackson simply is talking about exploitation that's economic, that sin we live in. When you find yourself victimized by environmental racism, that sin we live in. When you are on the job and you deal with misogyny and sexism, that is sin that you live in. If you are doing more work but getting less pay, that is sin that we live in. A lot of us go to church to hear about the sin within, but rarely do we go to church and hear about the sin we live in. And Jesus saves us from sin within and the sin we live in. Well, his name is Jesus, who saves us from us. His name is what? Jesus. Because his name is now Emmanuel, which means God with us. That's another name we celebrate. And that is because Jesus has come, we discovered that God is not some distant, disinterested deity, but God is with us. God is personal. God is involved in your life and in my life. God is not absent, but God is always present. I like that right there. God has a perfect attendance record in that God has a way of coming through when you're going through. God has a perfect attendance record in that God will not always take you out of a situation, but God will get in the situation with you because God has a perfect attendance record. I think I'll go ahead and just shout by myself right now, because if it had not been that the Lord was on my side, where would I be? I serve a God who has a perfect attendance record. God with us. But wait, because the text blows me away. Jesus is born in Bethlehem. Wise men come in their parade processional following the star, and as they follow the star, it leads them to the capital of Jerusalem, and there in Jerusalem, Herod finds out about this parade of wise men and wonders what's up. They tell him, we've come to worship the King of the Jews following his star. Our science has told us that he's born in this area. Herod now consults with the preachers on payroll, because every Herod has preachers on payroll, because Herod has to make sure that preachers justify whatever policies Herod is engaged in. Y'all didn't get that right there. But every Herod has a Billy Graham. Every Herod has a Robert Jeffries. Every Herod has preachers on payroll. And the Bible lets us know that when Herod consults with the preachers say, according to the word, he's to be born in Bethlehem. And of course, Herod tells the wise men head to Bethlehem. Here's why you know these preachers were on payroll and not following God, because they knew where the Savior was to be born, but they did not go to Bethlehem to worship him. Ain't that a trip? They know what's right, but they don't follow what's right. Ain't that a trip? The book lets us know the preachers on payroll, they know where the Savior was to be born, but they did not go and worship the Savior when he was born. Y'all, I'm scared of a preacher who's about preaching but not about worship. I'm scared of a preacher who can tell you what to do but won't follow what the word says themselves. And so the Bible lets us know the wise men go to worship Jesus. They present the Savior with gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. You know the story. And now the Bible lets us know that that God then warns the wise men. I'm about to shout right here about Herod and say, Herod is a lowlife. You need to go back home, but make sure you go another way. I think I'll stop right there, because maybe God's word for you in 24 is it is time to go another way. What you've been doing, where you've been going, ain't where you need to go in 2024, because if you do what you've done, you're gonna get what you got. And so it's very important that we make up our minds in 24, I'm going another way, because things ain't gonna get better until you make some changes. I'm simply trying to say it's time to go another way. And the text says they go another way. Herod finds out, goes on a murderous rampage and passes a death dealing genocidal public policy. It's a policy that is passed that every boy under 2 years of age in Bethlehem was to be killed. It's called genocide. Let's call it what it is going on in Gaza right now. It's called genocide, and this nation's hands are guilty with the blood of those who are being killed, because you are funding genocide in the name of what? Israel's security. But always understand what we say in the streets: no justice, no peace. If you want peace in Israel, you gotta have justice in Palestine. And so, my sisters and brothers, understand that here is what's going on. Boys are being killed. I think I'll park right there, because there's always on the agenda of Herod a determination to get rid of our young boys. And so our young boys find themselves in a juvenile justice system. Our young boys find themselves in a pipeline from school to prison, because that's a part of Herod's death-dealing policy. Herod is always out to get our children. Herod, my sisters and brothers, will have you in a city where environmental racism and food insecurity combine to make it impossible for kids to learn in school. Herod, my sisters and brothers, is low down with death-dealing policies. And so Joseph and Mary, they escape with the baby Jesus to Egypt, and there in Northeast Africa, they are able to hide out as refugees. They receive asylum, hiding out in Northeast Africa as refugees. They can hide in Egypt. They don't go to Europe, because he'd have stood out in Europe. He wouldn't have been able to hide in Europe. And so they go where you can blend in. They go where they can hide. And so you can't hide a blonde, blue-eyed baby in the hood. And so the book lets us know that they end up in Egypt, and there in Egypt they stay, receiving refuge and asylum. But wait, the book lets us know Herod dies, and when Herod dies, that's when the Bible says a dream comes to Joseph. You can head back to Israel, only to get to Israel and discover that Herod has offspring. Y'all, I think I'll stop right there, because black folk, we also oftentimes get comfortable because we forget that Herod has offspring. You see, not only does Herod have offspring, y'all didn't get that, I think I'll help you right now. We thought Nixon was bad with his southern strategy, but right after Nixon, here comes Reagan with his states' rights. Right after Reagan with his states' rights, here comes Daddy Bush being kinder and gentler. And then Daddy Bush has George W. Bush. And before you know it, here comes MAGA. MAGA, the most corrupt president in the history of this country, whose policies are baptized by Robert Jeffries downtown. I'm just trying to let you know, Herod always has offspring. And so we ain't got time to get comfortable. The struggle continues. We ain't got time to get comfortable. We got to fight every day because Herod has offspring. Preach, Freddie Haynes. I'm doing the best I can. Bible lets us know Herod has offspring. Here comes Herod, Archelaus, and Joseph doesn't want to go where Archelaus is. And now he ends up settling in Nazareth. And the book says it's so that what was spoken by the prophets could be fulfilled. He shall be called a Nazarene. That means Jesus grows up in Nazareth. Now, Nazareth was hood. It was so much hood. The Bible lets us know that when it was found that the Messiah was from Nazareth, somebody said, can any good thing come out of Nazareth? Y'all, Nazareth was straight hood, food desert, apartheid, a field with nothing but being on the outside. It's the backside of nowhere. That's what Nazareth is. It's the hood. And if NWA was rapping in the days of Jesus, they'd have dropped an album, and the album would have been called Straight Out of Nazareth. And that's what I want to talk about today, Straight Out of Nazareth. Why? Because think about it for just a second. Y'all don't judge me. It's the 50th anniversary of hip-hop, so let me give some hip-hop shout-out right now. Because when you check out the album Straight Out of Nazareth, what does NWA do? They go in on police brutality and the violence that characterizes life in Compton. They go in their album Straight Out of Nazareth. A lot of folk got upset about the profanity on the album because they really went there. But here's what gets me. Folk get mad about profanity, but don't get upset about the profane conditions that produce the profanity. And so Jay-Z would put it like this later on: God forgive me for my brash delivery, but I remember vividly what these streets did to me. Y'all didn't get that. I'm simply trying to say, before you judge the profanity, make sure you judge the profane condition that produced the profanity. I'm trying to let you know that that's what's happening. And so NWA, they rap, they go in, but here's what blesses me, and that is God has a way, no matter where you come from, of depositing genius and good and goodness. Even in Nazareth, God is so amazing that God says Nazareth ain't gonna define you. Nazareth is not going to be your destiny. Nazareth is where you are from, but you're going to transform and redefine where you are from. And so the text says Jesus is straight out of Nazareth. Jesus is straight out of the hood. Jesus shall be called a Nazarene. I'm going to unpack that in just a moment as we wrap this thing up. But understand, the book lets us know that God is so amazing that when life is at its worst, that's when God deposits God's best into your life and into your situation. God ain't done with you. God is with you in Nazareth. Emmanuel in Nazareth. Jesus saving us in Nazareth. God God shows up in Nazareth, that is the glory of this season. That's why I love the nativity scene with Jesus in the midst of the rubble, because where else would Jesus be but in the midst of devastation and destruction, reminding us he shows up with us in the midst of our pain. And that's the word God wanted me to give somebody who's going through hell and hardship right now. You ain't in this by yourself. God walks with you through your dark time. God holds you together when life is falling apart. God is with you in the midst of that which is wicked. God walks with us. God talks with us. God tells us that we are God's own. You're not by yourself. God is with you in Nazareth, because Jesus is the Savior who is straight out of Nazareth. What does it mean? What does it mean? I give you these and I'm done. It means that God, oh, I love this right here, gives us dreams that get us through our worst nightmares. Here's the nightmare. The nightmare is that a generation is killed. Right. The nightmare is Herod is on the throne. The nightmare is Herod has offspring. But the text says in the midst of the nightmare, God keeps giving Joseph dreams. Dreams do not negate the reality of the nightmare, but dreams let you know that the nightmare can't have the last word. Man, I'm almost feeling this thing right now. Dreams let you know nightmares are real. And please, whatever else you do, don't let prosperity pimping preachers make you think that nightmares ain't real. You can't claim your way out of a nightmare. You can't grab it and blab it, you're out of a nightmare. Nightmares are going to come. Jesus said in this world, you're going to have tribulation. Y'all, you're going to catch some hell even if you're on your way to heaven. I'm trying to let you know nightmares will come, but nightmares don't have the last word. God gives us a dream in a nightmare. Have you thought about the fact that we often get hyped about King declaring, I have a dream? But don't forget, the dream he articulated was right after the nightmare he narrated. King was talking about the American nightmare before Mahalia pushed him into saying, tell him about the dream, Martin. Y'all didn't shout. King was talking about the bad check that America had given us. King was talking about what had taken place in the South and about the voting rights that we did not have. He was articulating the American nightmare before he was pushed into declaring, I have a dream. Y'all still not getting this thing. King was not ignorant to the nightmare, but the nightmare did not stop him from having a dream. And that's why Langston Hughes said, hold fast to dreams, for if dreams die, life is a broken winged bird that cannot fly. Hold fast to dreams, for when dreams go, life is a barren field frozen with snow. The poet is saying, keep on dreaming. I know you're having a hard time, but you keep on dreaming. I know life has turned dark, but you keep on dreaming. I know you've lost your job, but keep on dreaming. I know you've lost a loved one, but you keep on dreaming. I know your heart is broken, but you keep on dreaming, because a dream is a possibility. possibility beyond your nightmarish reality. A dream lets you know there is more to what you're going through than what you're going through, and what you're going through is transportation to what you're going to. And so don't you give up in the midst of the nightmare. You keep on dreaming. Y'all know there was a dreamer named Joseph in Genesis. The Bible says he had a dream, and his dream took him through a nightmare, and he did not give up in the midst of the nightmare because the dream was more powerful than the nightmare. How do you think we made it as a people? We made it because when America gave us a nightmare, we've kept on dreaming in spite of the American nightmare. So y'all keep on dreaming. Don't you give up. Don't you give in. Keep on dreaming. And here's what I've discovered. Look at the text. The text says every time he dreamt, it took place when it was dark. The text says it was at nighttime. At nighttime, he got a dream of possibilities beyond the darkness. We went to go see Color Purple, and we got there. Watch this. Before the lights went out, we got there because we wanted to order food, and so we get to the theater, and watch what happens. All of a sudden, lights go out. Lights go out, not for the main feature, but for the previews. It got dark in order for us to see what was on the way. The previews let you know if you hang around and don't give up. The previews let you know if you keep on keeping on and keep coming back, you'll get to see what you're looking forward to. I'm trying to say to somebody in a dark situation, the previews are about to come on. I guess y'all didn't see the previews. It's gotten dark, but I gotta give you the previews. Weeping may endure for a night, but joy comes in the morning. Have y'all seen the previews? Even the youth shall faint and be weary. Young folks shall fall, but they that wait on the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles, run and not get weary, walk and not faint. I'm trying to show y'all the previews. I've got a feeling everything's gonna be all right. I'm trying to show y'all the previews. Delight yourself in the Lord and he'll give you the desires of your heart. I'm trying to give y'all the previews. Wait on the Lord. Be of good courage. He will strengthen your heart. I'm trying to give y'all the previews. The best is yet to come. I got to give you something else. Dreams, dreams get you through your nightmare, but also disruptions are for your redirection. Man, I'm about to shout. Text says Joseph receives a dream in Egypt. Herod's dead, leaves Egypt, heads back to Israel, and then hears Herod got a son who's a fool. Herod has Archelaus. He had really some other sons too, but this one is reigning over the region where God had sent Joseph, and Joseph then says, I ain't going there. He's afraid to go there. The alarm goes off. He recognizes the red flag, and that's when he's open to another dream that redirects him. What to? Nazareth. Because God can use disruptions for your redirection. Man, that's some good stuff right there. God can allow what has disrupted what you wanted. Watch this, to push you into God's plan. God is so good that what disrupts what you've gotten comfortable in is now setting you up for what God has designed for you. I'm still not coming through, because somebody needs to understand the job did not fire you. God freed you up to see what God had in store for you that you would not have been, that you would not have seen had you not experienced that firing. That fool did not break your heart. That fool broke up your plans so you could experience God's whole will for your life. God is so amazing that God can use what is disruptive in order to redirect you to what God has for you. That's a whole lot better than what you thought you had yourself. Okay, okay. I do it like this. Several years ago, I was in Philadelphia preaching on a Sunday morning, and I'm flying back from Philly to Dallas right after church that Sunday because the Cowboys were playing that night, and I had tickets. This is when we were playing at Texas Stadium, and so I was going to the game at Texas Stadium only to get in the environs of Dallas and put in a holding pattern, because the weather was bad and they said that there was a weather system literally over the airport in Dallas. And so we were on hold in Dallas, just going around and around on hold in Dallas because of a weather system that was hanging over the airport. So I'm getting upset because I got tickets. I want to get to the game, and I'm not feeling this right now. Sister next to me is saying, this is really sad. I hate to hear about this. And then she said, but guess what? I'm going to Dallas for, and I'm not asking her for this information because right now I'm trying to get to the game. And so she says, I'm going to Dallas for business. I really would like to see my grandbaby. My grandbaby was just born in Austin. It's my first grandchild, and I'd love to go see my grandbaby in Austin, but I got a business meeting, and I have a business meeting first thing in the morning. I have to get back to Philly tomorrow night, so I don't know if I'm going to get to see my grandbaby on this trip. I pray I get to. I said, well, I pray that for you as well. And then with attitude, I said it like that. I said, I pray that for you as well. She says, I'm very serious. You pray I get to see my grandbaby, because I haven't seen my grandbaby yet. I'd love to see my grandbaby in Austin. At that moment, Pilate comes over the PA system and says, the system is still hanging over DFW, and we're going to have to get gas. And so we're waiting for air traffic control to tell us where we can go to get gas. He then comes back 2 minutes later and says, they have in Austin a place for us to go and get gas. And that woman looked at me and she said, do you see God? She said, I'm going to see my grandbaby. Y'all, we landed in Austin. When we land in Austin, they say, if you want to get off the plane, you can, but you won't be able to get back on. She gathers her things and says, don't worry, I won't be getting back on. I'm going to see my grandbaby. Here's your shout right here. The storm disrupted her plans, but got her to see her grandbaby. I got to help somebody right now. God is so good. God will let a storm disrupt what you want to get you in God's will. I don't know who I'm talking to, but somebody's in church, somebody's online, and God will let your plans get disrupted to get you in God's will. I'm done. Here's the last piece. The text says, finally, here it is. He will be called a Nazarene. A Nazarene. This really speaks of what? A divine design out of what is ugly and unexpected. Watch this. I'm done. A divine design. He will, this happened in order to fulfill what the prophets said. He'll be called a Nazarene. Please don't miss that. What the prophets said, plural. What the prophets said. This is really Matthew bringing together a few of what he interprets as prophecies about the Messiah in order to understand what God has been up to behind the scenes. I love that right there. That God has been working behind the scenes, fulfilling God's purposes, because God can even take our personal disappointment and weave it into God's providential design. That's what I'm trying to say. And so here it is. what the prophets said. What prophets? Well, some say that it had to do with Nazarene, a play on what? Nazarite. Nazarite, which was a reference to Samson was a Nazarite. A Nazarite was one who was set apart for a divine purpose. And of course, Jesus was set apart for a divine purpose. So perhaps it's a play on Nazarite. Still other prophets, still other scholars, I'm sorry, talk about, no, it's not that as much as it is a play on the Hebrew word, what, Nazar? Which is in, thank you, which is in Isaiah chapter 11 verse 1, where in 11 verse 1, what does the Bible say? It speaks of the Messiah who would be a branch which would come out of the stump of Jesse. Please don't miss this. A stump is not a full tree. A stump is a tree that has been cut off, and yet a branch would come out of what was dead. New life would come out of what was dead. When you think it's over, something brand new comes out of what was supposed to be dead. I call him the Nazarene because it should have been done. It should have been dead, but out of that death came brand new life. Y'all still not shouting. I like his name. His name is Jesus. His name is Emmanuel. He's a Nazarene because that Nazarene comes out of what should have been dead to give us brand new life. Somebody came to church. Somebody's online, and the stump has caused you to feel that everything is over, but God is still able to bring new life out of a dead stump. Okay. Let's get ready for service tonight, but I can't let you go because I know you don't want me to let you go, because in your sensitivity, you're thinking about Chris and the Christmas from hell. Because Chris said it was a Christmas from hell interrupted by the God of heaven. Chris testified, and I'm done. Here's what Chris said. Chris said that he and his family are sitting in the dark when all of a sudden his 3-year-old granddaughter comes running down the steps, and the granddaughter is running down the steps with the flashlight on the cell phone of her mama. And the granddaughter runs down the steps with the flashlight of the cell phone of her mother, and she runs down the steps and she runs and says, "Granddaddy," to Chris. And she runs into Chris's arms and says, "Granddaddy, I'm so glad to spend Christmas with you, because there's nothing like being in the dark and all of us are together." And y'all, when she said that, here's what Chris kept saying over and over again. She said, "Pastor Haynes, that child brought tears to my eyes, because that child came down the stairs with light. That child came down the stairs and ran into my arms and told me that she loved me. That child told me, even though it's dark, that we were together." And all of a sudden, that dark Christmas, that Christmas from hell, was interrupted by the God of heaven because of that child. That child transformed the darkness for me. That child turned my darkness into day. That child turned darkness into light. I'm so glad that child told me that it loves me. That child let me know I wasn't by myself. Chris was talking about his granddaughter, but the more he kept saying that child, I had to talk about another child, because there's another child that came all the way from heaven down through 42 generations. For God so loved the world that God gave God's child for us. Aren't you glad for that child? It's that child that's the rose of Sharon. It's that child that's the lily of the valley. It's that child that's the bright and morning star. It's that child that's the root of Jesse. It's that child that's our branch. It's that child. I guess I'll quote the late great Charles Adam. That child is Adam's redeemer, Cain's vindicator, Noah's ark, Joseph's dream, Abraham's promise. I'm talking about that child. That child is Isaac's hope. That child is Jacob's ladder. That child is Deborah's victory. That child is Joseph's dream. That child is Moses's rod. That child is Joshua fitting the battle of Jericho. I'm talking about that child, the word of the prophets. That child, the rose of Sharon, the lily of the valley, Ezekiel's wheel in the middle of the wheel. I'm talking about that child. Does anybody know that child? I'll tell you about that child. Joy to the world. The Lord is come. Let earth receive her king. Let every heart prepare him room. And heaven and nature sing. He rules the world with truth and grace. And let the nations prove the glories of his righteousness and repeat the sounding joy. Hallelujah for that child. Does anybody know that child? That child woke me up this morning. That child is a healer. That child will raise you up when life knocks you down. Does anybody know that child? Hallelujah for that child. Listen, listen, heads bowed, eyes closed. Christians, please pray. Somebody came to church. You need that child to hug you. That child is still the light of the world. That child still shows up in your dark situations. That child still is here for us when we're going through what we're going through. That child is still Emmanuel. That child will save you from you. That child is a Nazarene, straight out of Nazareth, meaning no hood, no system can stop you from being what God intends for you to become. Don't you want to know that child? If you came to church and you know you need a relationship with that child, if you're online and you want a relationship with that child, call us right now, 469-498-0210. Email us, join us at friendshipwest.org. And today you can know that child. You can join church. You can do it today. If you're in the house, you ain't here by accident. God planned it because God wants you to have a relationship with that child who will show up in your darkness, bring you light, hug you, love on you, and give you a dream to get you through your nightmare. Who will allow your disruptions to get you where God intends for you to become. That child is able to somehow get a divine design when life goes ugly and through what is unlikely. And so if you're here and you're not saved, you're here. And you want a personal relationship with God through Jesus Christ, you're here. And you want to get to know that child. You ain't here by accident. God planned it. If you're here and you know good and well, it's time for you to get you out of the way of you so that God can save you from the you that gets you in the trouble that you've been getting into. If you're here and you're not saved, listen, here's what you do. Stand up, step out of the aisle you're in, come on down front and give your life to Jesus Christ. The last day of this year is a mighty good day to give your life to Christ. So if you're here and you're not saved, you're here and you're not in right relationship with God through Jesus Christ, you're here and you know you need connection with that child. Yeah, I see y'all coming. Bless your heart. Bless your heart. I love it. 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 Yeah, y'all, let's celebrate them coming. Hallelujah. Now listen, listen. You hear? Oh, yeah, yeah. I love it. I see y'all. Come on. That's right. Come on. Come on. Look at God. I love it. Here it is. Here it is. You hear? And you know you need a connection with that child. You're here, and you know that you want to get out of your own way, and you want to go another way in 24. What better way to go another way than to get with that child? So won't you come on right now? God bless your heart. Give your life to Christ. Yeah. Oh, you know you're making my day. Bless you. Somebody else, come on. Come on. Come on, do it right now. That's the only way you're going to handle this darkness. You need to know that child. And so if you're here and you're not saved, you're here, you need that connection. Won't you come right now? Stand up, step out, come on down. Give your life to Jesus Christ. Preacher, well, this is my deal. I got that part right, but I want to join church. I feel God leading me to join this church. If that's you right now, stand up, step out, come on down. Let's join church in 23. Begin 24. With a community of believers, a community of faith. Stand up, step out, come on down, and let's join church. Hallelujah, 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 bless your heart, hallelujah. Somebody else, somebody else, somebody else. Preacher, preacher, here's the deal. I just moved to Dallas-Fort Worth from another area. I got a church home back there, but now I live here. Work here, go to school here. I need a church home here. If that's you, stand up, step out, come on down. Join these who have come and are still coming. They still coming. Look at God, look at God. Somebody else right now, come on down. Join church. Do it right now. Preacher, here's my deal. I used to go to church. I stopped going. I want to get back in church. Today's your day. Stand up, step out, come on down. Let's get back in church. Today's your day. Here's the signal. We're getting ready to stand. When we stand, wherever you are, balcony, risers, main floor, stand up with us. And if you want to give your life to Christ, join church, stand up, step out of the aisle you're in, come on down front, give your life to Christ, and let's get to know that child and join a community of believers. Shall we stand? Come on down right now. Come on. Speaking to you right now. Don't you want to get out of the way of yourself? Only God can save us from us. That's why Jesus came. And so won't you right now, don't let this moment pass. God is speaking to you right now. That inner impulse you feel on the inside saying, yeah, go up there, that's God talking. The Bible says the day you hear God's voice, harden not your heart. And today is a mighty good day to say yes to Jesus, to get to know this child that came down for you as the light of the world. And so here it is, here it is. God is speaking, And God won't even let me stop the invitation because of you. And you know who you are. You wrestling, you going back and forth. Let me just say this. If you are wrestling with God, make sure you lose. That's the only way you're going to really win. And so we're going to help you. I need everyone right now, please whisper this prayer. God, please touch my neighbor if it's them. In Jesus' name, amen. Now listen, your neighbor just prayed for you. If it's you we're waiting on, if it's you God is speaking, choir's going to sing that one more time. And while they're singing, that's your cue. Step out of the aisle you're in. Come on down front. Give your life to Christ. Get to know this child. Do it right now. Do it today. God is speaking. Come on right now. Come on. Sing it.
Welcome home. Welcome home. Hallelujah. I love it. I love it. I love it. Let me pray for you. God, thank you so much for new life in Christ. Thank you for a Savior who saves us from ourselves, saves us from the sin around us. We thank you for Emmanuel. Thank you that you are with us. Thank you for the Nazarene in the hood, giving us healing, hope, and help. Thank you for new life in Christ. Thank you for community. God, bless these your children. Fill them with your Holy Spirit. Order their lives in your word. Use us as their family to love on them, connect with them, and be for them what they need as they become all you intend for them to. Thank you now. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. God bless you. Please go with our ministers, counselors. Come on, y'all. Let's celebrate our new family one more time. Wow, that is amazing. That is awesome. That is so awesome. That is so awesome. While you're at it, praise God again for our amazing music ministry. Y'all blessed us. Thank you, Saul. Thank you. Thank you so much. And did the praise dancers do the thing or what? Those praise dancers ushered us into God's presence. Thank you, praise dancers. Bless your hearts. Listen, we're getting ready to go. I need your prayers this week. Got a call from our attorney. And on Wednesday, as you know, we've been in a fight against a sick system that will allow a truck yard to be built across from a community, a high school, and next to a church. And so we're in a fight. And so Wednesday is our court hearing for the injunction we filed. And so I have to testify on Wednesday. And so I'm asking you to be in prayer for us as we go to testify. We need Joe Dillard there.
also, Vita, to testify. So we're going on Wednesday. We'll be in court on Wednesday. So be in prayer. Also, Pastor Magruder is leading our fight. We used to have at our Keys location a DART bus stop. And you know, the services that we give there are for persons who ride the bus. You know, they got rid of that bus stop. And so Pastor Magruder is leading the fight to get the DART to bring the bus stop back. And that's the third, right? That's the third, which is what day? Wednesday? Wednesday the third. So Wednesday is going to be a day of fighting. But that's what we do. And so we're going to be fighting on Wednesday to get the bus stop back. And we're going to be fighting against the development they're trying to do to harm our community. So please keep us in prayer. I'm going to do everything I can to call a community meeting so we can get together with our strategy about what we're looking at doing going forward. And so I want you to be prepared for that as we get ready to go. I really apologize for being missing in action for the last few weeks, but I'm glad that you all were praying and on the case. Now, here's what I need. Here's what I need. I need my voice for two more. And so what I'm going to do, as much as I want to greet you and love on you, I'm going to head out, okay? And so please keep on praying, keep on praying. And know I'm praying for you as well. Receive God's benediction. The Lord bless you. The Lord keep you. The Lord cause God's face to shine on you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up the light of God's countenance upon you and grant you peace. Go now in the power of God's Holy Spirit, knowing you serve a Savior straight out of Nazareth. And his name means he is with you. He'll save you from you and what's around you. And he'll give you help, hope, and healing, even in the hood. In Jesus' name, peace.
We praise God for this impactful experience and for your joining us during it. Check us out on social media. And please like, share, and subscribe at Friendship West. Then go to www.friendshipwest.org to find out more about this marvelous movement. Find out how to participate through sharing your prayers, sharing your offerings or monetary gifts, or sharing and investing your time volunteering with this difference-making ministry. For you who are viewing as visitors, you can share that you are here by taking time to text FWVIZ to the number 28950. For those who want to, this time that you are visiting to be the last time that you're a visitor, you can become part of our fabulous family of faith, either by calling 469-498-0210 or by emailing joinus@friendshipwest.org with your first name, your last name, and your cell number. Either way, we look forward to hearing from you. We're so excited that you are here. Until next time, blessings on you. Friendship West Baptist Church.